today I think we had the speaker from Texas A&M. So let me briefly introduce the speaker, Paul Cousins. Dr. Cousins is the research engineer at the Texas A&M Transportation Institute, TTI. It is a member of the Texas A&M University System. He is the division head of the traffic operations and the road safety division, where he is responsible for leading the research program globally focused on design and operations. He coordinates the state traffic safety and design research, promotes national research initiative, facilitates the sponsor interaction, and manages a number of research projects. So with that, please join me in welcoming the board to the talk.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are y'all?
Good.
It's a pleasure to be here, finally. We've been trying to set this up for a while. As James said, I am at Texas A&M University, Texas Transportation Institute, and I serve many roles there. I'll describe those briefly for you. And I'll talk about some ongoing research we have that has some overlap to what's happening here at Georgia Tech. So, a couple of the titles that I officially carry at Texas A&M. I am first and foremost a research engineer at the Texas Transportation Institute, which is a part of Texas A&M University, where we do a lot of different types of infrastructure-related research. I think TTI likes to say that they're the largest transportation institute in the United States. We do about $70 million worth of research a year, and there's about 700 people at TTI. We're always looking for new graduates who are interested and have a passion for research. So if that's what you want to do, as opposed to going tenure track when you're done, look us up. The other thing I also do is I'm a faculty member of the Civil Engineering Department and Mechanical Engineering Department, and I'm also a fellow at the Texas A&M University, which basically just means I get to do a lot of administrative stuff and don't get extra time or pay for that. I'll talk to you a little bit about the professional roles that I carry at the national level so you get a flavor of where my wheelhouse is and what I like to do. So I'm really a traffic control devices person, and I've been spending my career doing traffic control devices. I started at Penn State University, and since about 1990, I've been doing research in traffic control devices almost exclusively. And so that means a lot of different things, though. I've done a lot of work from human factors and driver understanding of traffic control devices to the materials and to the durability, and now more than ever, vehicle-sensor interaction related to traffic control devices and asset management of those. So at TRB, I'm currently serving my last year as chair of the Traffic Control Devices Committee. I've also served as chair of the Signing and Marking Materials Committee. I've been a chair at TRB for 15 straight years, and I'm thankful that this is my last year of that. And I'm not going to take any more roles on at TRB for a while. At the National Committee, I'm the chair of the Research Committee, and I'm an executive board of the National Committee. Is everybody familiar with National Committee? This is the organization that provides the lion's share of recommendations on the MUTCD, the federal highway. We generally write 90% of the material in the MUTCD and federal highway. Although they have full authority and they own the MUTCD and maintain it, most of the work that is in the manual comes out of the National Committee. I'm heavily involved in ASTM, as Rick knows. Good to see you here. And on the IPE, I serve as a delegate to the National Committee Council. And then I have several roles in ASHTO. The one that's probably most relevant to the talk I give today is I'm chairing a new joint works with SAE. We're developing a specification for markings for machine vision. And what I like to talk about that particular role, and this is where I think is fascinating about the space that we're in today, is with all the technology and hype going into vehicles, there's the need for a new bridge to be built between the infrastructure industry and the vehicle industry. And it's amazing to me, but SAE for 100 years has been representing the vehicle industry, and for 100 years Astro's been representing highways, right? How many times do you think those organizations have worked together in 100 years? Big ol' zero. This is the first time that there's been a joint effort between Astro and SAE. So we've been building roads for 100 years, we've been building cars for 100 years, and besides literally where the rubber hits the road, those two organizations have never worked together on anything. To me, that's just an area that is ripe with opportunity, and with all the transformations happening in the vehicle space, it's requiring more communication between the automotive side and the infrastructure side. And so as a student, if you're pursuing a degree in civil engineering or some other engineering aspect, this to me, at least related to what's happening in the world today, is the most exciting thing we've had happen in decades. And it's provided a lot of opportunity, and I don't even think we're scratching the surface of the opportunity that's available as technology comes into play more so than today. And that's really what I'm going to be talking about today, is how technology is transforming what we've traditionally done on the infrastructure side. There's a lot happening there. Obviously, there's a lot of great work happening here at Georgia Tech related to that. James just shared with me for the last 30 minutes all the innovative and leading things that are happening here. And it's similar at TTI. So I'll share with you a couple things that we're doing. With NCHRP, TxDOT, and other sponsors, private sponsors and other public sponsors in at least two areas. So these are the topics today. So I'm going to talk to you today about, bless you, markings for machine vision. I think most of folks are familiar with lane departure warning systems and lane keep systems, and we hear people like GM, Ford, and others, including Tesla, Elon Musk, talk about we need better markings on the road today. And you know, they've gone to Congress and they've told Congress, if the infrastructure people would only provide us better markings, we'd be able to do automation better. But when you turn around and ask them, what do you mean better markings? Their answer is, well, you know, just paint the roads better, keep the white lines better, keep the yellow lines maintained better. But they don't know what they're really asking for. They don't know the terms that we use to maintain and design pavement markings. And when you sit down and start to talk to them and their technical people about what they need, you get a little bit of information, but they still don't really know. So we've been doing work to try to understand, what can we do with pavement markings to provide more reliable and consistent machine vision detection for those ADAS systems such as lane departure warning and lane keep? So I'll talk to you a little bit about what's going on in that space, what we're learning, and what states are already starting to do. I think that's there's a few states out there that are on the leading edge, and I'll share with you some of the things that they're doing. And then we're doing another project with Texas DOT, and I'll talk a little bit about that because I know that there's a lot of overlap between what is happening in that space and what's happening here at Georgia DOT. With that particular one, I'm going to try to show you a YouTube video, and I'm going to try to get online to show you some data that we're currently mapping using crowdsourcing strategies. And so we'll see how that works. If it doesn't work, I'll just talk through it. But I'm going to rely on technology for that, and we'll see if the technology cooperates. So let's talk about the current vehicle technology, because I feel like And y'all may have a better understanding of this than most of my audience, because generally I'm talking to USDOT and different state agencies, and there's general confusion about automated vehicles and ADAS features and the sensors that go into those types of different suites of technology. And I'd like to level the playing field before I get too far into the slide deck. Okay, so this is basically, if you were to buy the most advanced vehicle today, minus the Teslas, minus the Super Cruise, and minus the Audis that will be available with level 3 automation next year, this is what you get. Okay, so these are basically the ADAS features that are available on vehicles today, and the sensors that make them happen. And these sensors have been around for a decade or so. They're not anything new. But when it comes to machine vision or pavement markings and sign detection, the cameras that are being used for those types of features are very low quality cameras. They're grayscale cameras. They don't even have color. And they generally operate at a range of 30 to 50 feet in front of the vehicle. Okay, so those cameras that if you go buy a car today, that's generally what you have. And when I talk about this, our findings today, this is an important piece of information to keep in mind, because we've been researching what do we need to do with the infrastructure today, or what do we need to do with the infrastructure to accommodate the technologies today, not the AV technologies that you always hear about in the news and in the media. I'm talking about technologies that are available today and on cars today. From an infrastructure owner, operator, maintainer, what can we do to accommodate those technologies today without giving up everything that we've designed the system for already, which is generally the human vision. So that's sort of some background and some general understanding I need you to get a grasp of as we go through the slide deck. So I want to talk a little bit about the safety potential for these technologies, because this is what gets me excited. Okay, we've been working to try to mitigate crashes, and we have in the civil engineering space, we've been trying to infrastructure our way out of safety. Okay, and when I say infrastructure our way out of safety, we're using high friction surface treatments on curbs, we're using brighter and bigger signs, we're milling grooves into the pavement to, you know, rumble strips, right? We're doing all these things to infrastructure our way out of safety. But what's happening to the safety numbers nationally? They keep going up, right? Something, you know, so we got to do something different. And I think some of these technologies that are available today have a lot of potential, and we're starting to see that. So this is a study that came out of CMU last year that starts to, and we're starting to get enough of these technologies in the fleet today where we're able to start really doing some reliable statistical analysis on, well, what effect will lane departure have? What effect will forward collision warning have? And these are all machine vision safety features, right? Well, the blind spot monitoring is more of an ultrasonic, but the first two are clearly machine vision supplemented maybe with radar. But you can see the potential that these particular safety features have. This is a report that just came out of the Insurance Institute last month. Or I say last month, it's 2 months ago now that we're in October. But it starts to, and these guys have more data available than anybody, because they have all the reported crash data from the insurance companies available to also analyze, in addition to reported crashes. So they generally get a little bit of a head start in understanding what vehicle technologies are going to offer. And so their latest report shows lane departure warning having some significant impact in crashes, roadway departure crashes specifically. And they looked at their analysis two different ways. The first numbers that you see there are probably moderate, probably underestimate the potential, and the second one probably overstates it. But they all agree that there's generally a lot of potential for these types of technologies. If the road marking is in adequate condition, but what does adequate condition mean? And that's what I'm working towards. So this is what Federal Highway focuses on, okay? So if you're up at, you know, DC, you're trying to be data-driven, you're trying to infrastructure your way out of safety, and you look at the crashes, and I'm like, okay, if you split the fatalities up in the United States, over half of them are roadway departure crashes. How can we keep vehicles on the road? That's our number one goal. If we can just keep them on the road, we're gonna mitigate the biggest pie, the biggest slice of pie in terms of fatalities. And we've been doing that primarily with rumble strips, but rumble strips can't go in everywhere. If you have a house next to a road, the first thing you're gonna tell the DOT is don't put rumble strips in front of my house. I don't like the noise. And that is a real complaint, and that keeps DOTs from putting rumble strips on miles and miles of road. If I don't have a shoulder and I'm on a windy two-lane road, I can't put a rumble strip in, right? If I'm in Texas or probably many places in Georgia, I don't have the pavement depth to mill in a rumble strip. So you can't use rumble strips everywhere. But if I have adequate edge lines and I have a real cheap camera in my car, I can have effective lane departure warning and lane keep assist features for relatively minimal costs. So the reach is much greater than infrastructuring our way out of it. And there's a lot to be said about this technology, but we still can't answer the simple question, what do I need to do with my road marking in order for these technologies to work? And so that's what we've been primarily doing at TTI for the last 12 months. Well, really we started internally trying to answer that question. But more recently, we have had NCHRP funding to supplement what we were already doing internally. So I'm going to talk to you about some specific research we have ongoing that's listed here. An NCHRP study where we're trying to develop a specification that says, if I'm Georgia DOT and I choose to maintain my road markings for technologies that offer lane departure warning and lane keep, this is what I need to do with my markings. Then we also have some other work from the group is called ATSA, American Traffic Safety Services Association. They represent the contractors that build and maintain the roads. They provided additional funding to supplement that NCHRP piece. And I'll talk a little bit about that. And then lastly, we just kicked off a new project where we're trying to develop a roadway classification scheme so that agencies such as GDOT and others could develop, much like functional classifications, if you're familiar with the Green Book, functional classifications that talk about how ready is my road for these different types of technologies on the vehicles today. So it could potentially complement the SAE levels of automation, but it isn't necessarily meant to do that. It's meant for agencies to understand how ready are my interstates, how ready are my U.S. highways, or for different levels of technology. So one of the things that we have the fortune to have at Texas A&M is what we call the RELIS campus. This is a 2,000-acre facility that was provided to the university in the 60s. It was formerly an Air Force base used to train in the Korean conflict and World War II fighter pilots. After the 50s and 60s, it was provided to the university. And so this is where we do generally most of the type of work that I'll be talking about today. Just to give you some feel, those long runways are 7,000 feet long, 300 feet wide, and some of the other spaces are much wider, even though they're shorter. So we have a lot of opportunity to do different types of configurations and different type of research out here. And it really is one of the things that makes it nice to be at TTI and have a facility like this that we can go to do all sorts of different types of work. So what we did in this study to understand what do road markings need to do is we installed new old markings. Okay, so I know that sounds weird, but we needed a series of markings that looked old, but controllably old, so that we could test different machine vision systems and start to understand where do machine vision systems begin to become unreliable. And then characterize those pavement markings so that we can start to see where that fall off is. So what we did is we installed six pairs of yellow markings and six pairs of white markings, 4-inch wide markings and 6-inch wide markings. And we had both tape and paint in this study, and they were provided by the largest manufacturers of tape and paint in the world, actually, 3M and M. So we had some good cooperation from industry, and this is just a photo of us installing this custom-made tape. It was brand-new tape, but it was designed to look like it was 5 to 10 years old, and we had six different levels of that, you know, that we designed and manufactured for the study. So what we were doing was we would drive this vehicle through the road markings that we installed. Under different conditions, daytime, nighttime, wet, dry, cloudy, glare, and we were primarily collecting data and reliability data from the machine vision system, but we were also collecting a lot of LiDAR data too for additional purposes. This is just some of the technology that was in the vehicle, a view from in the vehicle. For the camera that we used for lane departure warning and lane keep, we worked with Mobileye to acquire a specially designed Mobileye system that we could have access to some data that wouldn't normally be available. And we used Mobileye because if you go buy a vehicle with lane departure warning right now,